distinguished guests, our honoured speaker, the Right Honourable the Lord Judge PC. One and all, good evening, and welcome also to our online audience as well as anybody in the room with us today. My name is Professor Tim Dunn. I'm the Provost and Senior Deputy Vice Chancellor at the University of Surrey. Before we commence proceedings, I would like to advise everyone that we are not anticipating any fire alarms to go off, but if they do, we have exit doors there, and then at the back, I've always wanted to do that, at the back, we also have exit doors at the top of the steps, but we're not planning on any emergencies. It gives me the greatest pleasure to welcome you to the third Toulson Law Lecture, and this evening, we're delighted to host Lord Igor Judge on this auspicious occasion. In previous years, we have had the honour of listening to Lady Hale and Lord Neuberger. The Toulson Law Lecture was created in honour of Lord Roger Toulson, who was an inspiring jurist and one of the greatest legal minds that served the Supreme Court. He had a stellar career at the bar after graduating from Cambridge and became Queen's Counsel in 1986. In 2016, he retired as Judge of the Supreme Court and was appointed Visiting Professor at the University of Surrey Law School. This annual lecture series, named in his honour, is now in its third year and forms part of Surrey's Global Challenges Forum. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Lady Toulson, who represents the family, who will say a few words of welcome. Lady Toulson.
Lord Lieutenant, High Sheriff, distinguished guests and friends and colleagues. It's wonderful to be back. We had a hiatus, as you all know, for the last 2 years, and we couldn't have the lecture, actually. So, and I must say to all of you who know of friends who are not here tonight, it will be possible to see it virtually. It will be streamed, so that's wonderful. I am thrilled on behalf of the family to say how happy we are that the lecture has resumed and has resumed with a very dear friend and colleague of Roger's, Lord Judge. They served together for many years. I'm sure that Igor will speak about that a little bit. I just want to share with you that the guiding stars for Roger throughout his time as a barrister and indeed on the bench were four things: the rule of law, the independence of the judiciary, the sovereignty of Parliament, the separation of powers. All of those were guiding lights to him in the work that he did and the service that he gave to the law. We are, as a family, very, very appreciative of Lord Judge coming here and delivering the lecture this evening. And we are brimming with anticipation. So on that note, I should like to hand you over.
Thank you. Well, Lord Lieutenant, High Sheriff, Professor Dunn, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, and in particular, Lady Toulson, I'm very touched to have been asked to give this lecture. I mean, it does bear saying again, Roger was an exemplary judge and a great jurist, and there's something more to be added. He was a lovely human being, and that matters. Whether he was sitting in crime or civil, administrative law or commercial law, at any level, he was the classic all-rounder, expert in them all. Now, I know he didn't play cricket, he played rugby, that was his game, and he skied rather dangerously. But if in cricket terms, he could have batted for England, he could have bowled for England, he could have wicket kept for England, I'm not sure he could have umpired for England because you're supposed to be neutral. But what I'm trying to get across is that there was no area of the law in which he was not expert. He had the gift of reducing the most complex problems to their essence, and even more important for a senior judge, to use language which made his meaning clear. You didn't have to get a dictionary out to understand what Lord Toulson was saying. That cannot be said of every judge you've ever come across. And he was also the kind of judge that everybody was very happy to appear in front of. He had no side, he had no delusions of grandeur, he had, to the contrary, a commitment to helping both sides to get across the best of their cases. And in particular, to leave that the losing party leave court understanding why they had lost and at least happy. Not happy, people don't leave court happy when they've lost, but happy in the knowledge that they'd had a full and understanding hearing. And of course, all that took him to adorn the Supreme Court for alas too short a time. Roger was my friend. We all have friends. We can't describe what is lovely about each friend, at least in the same terms, because each friendship is different. But perhaps one of the most important things someone in office, which I had at the time, can have is a friend with whom you can discuss any issue or problem, confident that you will be told what the person you're confiding is actually thinks. I don't remember Roger ever telling me something because I wanted to hear it. I do frequently remember him telling me what he thought differently to me. And I thought that was a very good example to illustrate something very profound about his character, which is that he was a man of utter integrity. It's terribly easy to compromise when somebody says, "What do you think?" And you don't really agree, but you don't disagree, so you say you agree. I'm afraid we all do it. Roger wasn't like that. He told it as it was. I miss him, and we all miss him. But the topic for this lecture reflects some of the conversations that Roger and I had. The Overmighty Executive. We live in a democracy, so I'm going to ask you all a question for you to at least think about. Then I'll give you the answer. I'll give you my answer. It may not be the same answer as you have. What event do you think most clearly demonstrates that we live in a democracy? Give you a few seconds to think about it. I'll tell you what it is for me. The most vivid demonstration is the moment after a general election when the defeated Prime Minister literally walks out of 10 Downing Street. No farewells, no solemnity, a lot of television cameras, not a single band playing, hardly time to pack a toothbrush. And at that moment, the most powerful man or woman in the country is suddenly just another citizen walking down the street, bereft of all executive power. I think that's the most wonderful thing that happens, not because I have particular views about which ones should go and which shouldn't, of course, you understand I'm neutral, but because that is a demonstration of a democracy at work. And then all that power that he or she had is suddenly vested in the leader of the party who's won the election. Then there's the merriment, the triumph, some very carefully prepared chosen words. He or she enters the same house and takes over the same executive power. So far, so good. And within not longer than 5 years, the government is accountable to the electorate and the cycle recurs. And in the meantime, the Prime Minister forms the government, which is required to obtain the consent of Parliament for its legislation and is answerable for the lawfulness of its actions in open court hearings before an independent judiciary. Doesn't it sound like a magnificent constitution? We call it the sovereignty of Parliament, or more accurately, the Queen in Parliament. And no doubt, as I am speaking to you, it gives us all a very warm glow. Yes, yes, we're very happy with the sovereignty of Parliament and the Queen in Parliament. What I want to do today is to address an aspect of our Constitution which gets much less attention than it should and is rather less warming. In the real world, the monarch, that's the first part of the Queen, will assent and must assent to legislation which has passed its parliamentary progress. I think the last time the Queen did not do so was Queen Anne in 1707. And it is inconceivable that any monarch would turn down, refuse to do do her part, his part, in this parliament, in this process. As for the Lords, which is supposed to be a separate, distinct part of Parliament, it is not permitted to be involved in money bills. It cannot do more than delay any other bill, except for two. One is the removal of judges, which requires both houses to agree, and one a very important provision which hang on to, and particularly if you're young, hang on to it, a proposal by the government that it will extend its time in office beyond the five-year period. For that particular measure, there needs to be consent from the House of Lords. And in the end, therefore, our constitutional principle, however we dress it up as the sovereignty of Parliament, it is that the elected Commons, by majority voting in the elected chamber, must win. That's as it should be. They are elected, no one else is. We can throw them out, we can return them to power. And we have to appreciate, don't we, that any government, whatever its party politics are, needs a secure parliamentary foundation if it is to be in a position to make and implement, we do sometimes forget, implement all the very difficult policy decisions which are a constant concomitant of power. And just because we are in a parliamentary democracy, consistent parliamentary support is essential. That applies with particular force to primary legislation, that is, acts of Parliament, where there is a lengthy process designed to make legislation which A, achieves the government's objective, and B, enables it to do so as clearly as possible. And for the moment, I'm sticking to primary legislation. Some of you will remember President de Gaulle. He was not the greatest admirer of this country's system that anybody could ever remember, but he did lavish praise on our constitutional arrangements, highlighting this in particular: your executive and your legislative powers are balanced and work together. Well, today they continue to work together. That is not surprising. Over 100 MPs are members of the government. And that does tend to give, you know, in a race, that would give them government a fairly good starting point. My argument, however, is that in relation to primary legislation, even if he was correct 60 years ago, the constitutional balance is now heavily weighted in favour of the executive. And we need to reflect, if I'm right about that, that the heart, the historic heart of our development, the development of our constitution, Parliament emerged to protect us from authoritarianism, from despotism, from an overmighty monarch who believed in the divine right of kings. I suspect that the executive today has a perception of our constitutional arrangement on the basis that the executive, which commands an overall majority in the Commons, is vested with virtually absolute legislative authority. Viscount Hailsham's elective dictatorship from 50 years or so ago. The executive is entitled to, I quote, get its business through. That's the end of the quote. Apart from that, apart from the numbers of ministers in the legislature, the situation is exacerbated by societal change. Society is always changing. Constitutions don't necessarily catch up with societal change as quickly as perhaps should. Let me illustrate my point. Turn on your television any day, practically any day, and someone on the television is asking, hoping, sometimes demanding that the government should do something about whatever the crisis he or she thinks is affecting him or his organization or his charity or his party or whatever it might be. Maybe financial support, maybe a new law to prevent something, maybe another new law to demand something, to require it. And of course, that's nothing to do with the demands on social media, which you can all think about. And the demand we make on the television is for immediate responses. The answer has to be done quickly. And in the search for a daily headline, all executives, this is nothing to do with which party is in power now, all executives, whatever party is in power, want to be seen to be doing something. Do any of you watch westerns? I hope you do. Well, that's a very disappointing show of hands. How many of you like westerns? Ah, that's a better show. Not many of the young, how interesting. Do you remember The Magnificent Seven? So the bully comes into the village, beats them all to pulp, takes all their belongings, and lo and behold, they're bereft of all their food, all their supplies. So the villagers come out, and one of them comes and shouts out loudly, "We must do something!" And the clever one says, "But what?" And there's too much of the "we must do something." While we're talking about westerns, I could have got a very good degree in westerns. I offer you this choice. Okay, here's a really good question for your exams, for some general paper, of which, you know, if you're marked for a first, if you get this one right, you get the most super fantastic first that you can imagine. What is the difference between a man's got to do what a man's got to do, high noon, or a man's got to do what's got to be done, Shane? Now, there you are. Think about that one. End result, poor legislation. The ability of the Commons to act as an objective, dispassionate scrutiny of the executive starts to fail because the executive itself wants something done. I was talking to Professor Dunn at the beginning, and I think I discourteously forgot to thank you for introducing me. I'm so sorry. How many of you have read Thomas Hobbes's Leviathan? When I asked that question, somebody said, "Oh God." It's not a jolly read, but it is to do with power. And we have to face the fact that in our society, we are more demanding of government, and increasingly demanding of government, and increasingly demanding of government. And Hobbes would say, well, you need a powerful government. And the more we demand of our governments, the more the governments will turn to us and say, yes, we need more power. It's a very interesting and delicate balance. That's not Hobbes's Leviathan, that's Igor Judge commenting on Hobbes's Leviathan. But the other problem is that we also require our members of parliament to focus their attention on their constituencies. Perfectly understandable. I'm not in any way being critical. I'm facing the reality. My view and everything I've seen suggests to me that our members of parliament as a whole work exceptionally hard. But I suspect that legislative scrutiny, looking at these bills word by word, because it's word by word that makes the laws, reading every bill and sometimes all the vast provisions in them, and then making up their own minds about the merits or otherwise, has become a less dominant feature of their work. And they are entirely dependent on the amount of time that the government of the day allows them. It controls the business of the Commons. So it makes it harder to take a stand. And it may be very hard indeed to identify when the principal stand should be taken. For many years now, as the lawmaking has become a flood, self-restraint by the executive has been steadily declining. Now, this is all to do with primary legislation. You're constantly referred to the manifesto. There's a mantra, it's otherwise the Salisbury Convention, which emerged from a very sensible decision by the Lords when Clement Attlee's party was elected to power after the war. A strong Labour government. In the Lords, only hereditary peers. And the vast majority of them were totally opposed to Clement Attlee's manifesto. And so in the Lords, it was decided that just because they disagreed with any particular provision consequent on the manifesto, if it was in the manifesto, it would be passed by the Lords. The Lords would not hold it up. That saved a constitutional crisis. In passing, that was an 8-page document. The whole of the transformation of society between 1945 and 1950 was based on 8 pages. Today, manifestos are 10 times longer, in tiny print, and the idea that everyone who votes for a party agrees with everything in the manifesto strikes me as utterly daft. You vote for the party that, on the whole, represents what you think is best needed. Now, in law, it has no force. If it did, every government that I can remember would have been acting unlawfully. Because, as always happens with every government, governments sometimes fail to implement their manifestos. Sometimes they act in flagrant breach of an apparent manifesto commitment. Nobody sends for the Prime Minister and puts him and the Cabinet in the dock. We were promised in the manifesto a first-year constitution, democracy, and rights commission to examine how our constitution works. Walks. Well, where is it? It's not here. We've not had it. It's been put off and put off, probably because the subject's very difficult. But whether that's the reason or not, it was a promise that it would happen in the first year. Besides which, manifestos don't provide for the unexpected. They don't provide for COVID. They don't provide for Ukraine. And so governments have to be flexible. Of course they do. And I also perfectly happy to agree that achievement of manifesto commitments is an entirely obvious starting point for a legislative process. But it doesn't provide the justification for inadequate legislative scrutiny. But between the mantra of the manifesto and getting the government business done, the sovereignty of Parliament in its full sense is not quite the preeminent principle that it once was. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no perfect balance between the executive and the legislature. There couldn't be. It is perhaps symbolic, though, and it's only symbolic, that in the legislation a few weeks ago, which ended the fixed-term Parliament Act, you remember the deal between the Conservatives and the Lib Dems in 2010, the legislation actually expressly resurrected the royal prerogative. So in reality, vested in the Prime Minister absolute power to dissolve Parliament as and when he or she pleases, and for whatever reason, or indeed none at all. And some of you will remember, if you read any history at all, that our forefathers who sat in the parliaments of James I and Charles I, in particular the Long Parliament, were desperate to have that prerogative power abolished. And indeed, in 1640s, the Long Parliament did, that when the king came back, he resumed his prerogative power. It's an irony. No one political party is responsible for this. I really mean that. I'm not trying to be neutral. I am neutral about it. No one party is. But then let me exemplify the point in just a little further, in a subject in which Roger Toulson and I took a very close and very troubled interest, and just see how things move. In June 2003, an announcement was made by Mr. Blair, then commanding a huge majority in the Commons, that the office of Lord Chancellor would be abolished. Mark my word, an announcement was made. The Lord Chief Justice heard about it when he was standing outside a car I was in, and the radio actually said it was going to happen. Now, it was a constitutional revolution, not merely because the Lord Chancellor existed in literally hundreds of statutes, but it also had this terrible effect. It removed from the cabinet the one senior minister responsible solely for the administration of justice, the rule of law, and the independence of the judiciary. You can see why Roger and I were rather concerned. Mere announcement, without consultation by anyone, least of all the judiciary, and we now know from later biographies, autobiographies, that it was deliberately kept secret from everyone. Someone might have had the courtesy to ask the Lord Chief Justice what he thought of the likely impact of abolishing the Lord Chancellor's office. But my real point at this stage is lawmaking proposals by an announcement of a proposal of this magnitude does rather demonstrate that the executive has an assumption that its majority in the Commons will automatically endorse that assumption and will endorse the announcement. And at worst, from the government's point of view, possibly face a short delay in the Lords, and indeed the announcement did become embodied in the Constitution Reform Act of 2005. And now let's move on. The Lord Chancellor, became a Minister of Justice, became the holder of a relatively junior cabinet post. There was a compensation. We had a Minister for the Constitution, but that office was no longer of cabinet rank. And the downgrading goes on. Now no one holds the office of Minister for the Constitution. There isn't one. And that downgrading process may explain how, in the autumn of 2019, with Brexit about to run out of time, had to be done by the end of December, in the United Kingdom Internal Markets Bill, the government successfully asked the Commons to approve three provisions which, as the minister expressly accepted — this wasn't a legal argument — expressly accepted when the question was asked in the Commons, constituted a breach of our own legal obligations. This in our country, which advertises itself as respecting and having a profound commitment to the rule of law. It passed in the Commons. The Lords thumpingly rejected it. The governments urgently needed the rest of the bill and accordingly was forced to accept the amendments, not because it agreed, but because it was running out of time in the context of Brexit. How had such a proposal ever escaped the scrutiny of the Commons? And second, would anyone have dared to put forward that proposal when the old-fashioned Lord Chancellor existed, when Lord Mackay of Clashfern was the Lord Chancellor, or Lord Irving? One Conservative, one Labour. And the answer is, we've got to get the business done. But the further answer is, if you mess about with the Constitution, it is to the peril of the Constitution. My own strong view is that any constitutional change should follow cross-party discussions, because next time round it'll be the other lot in power. And we should have the courtesy, if humanly possible, to let everybody with a political interest have an opportunity, proper discussion, and if possible, agreement. This is our constitution, you know. It's your constitution. It's not the politician's constitution. This is what you and I are governed by. And in the context of the constitution, of course, prime ministers just come and they go. Now, that's primary. Delegated legislation sounds unimportant, particularly as it's called secondary legislation as well. Do you mind if I just pause for a sip of water? But effectively, it gives executive powers to ministers, not least to change laws with virtually no parliamentary scrutiny. I mean, to a constitutionalist, that sounds astonishing. It should be. Of course we don't need an act of parliament. Say our pavements should be this high, or a road sign should be red, white and black to make it lawful or unlawful for you to go through the speed limit. So of course we don't need it for that. But delegated legislation frequently covers major issues. Over 500 statutory instruments, the consequence of delegated legislation, were used to tackle the coronavirus pandemic. Now, you won't need me to remind you, it gave the widest possible powers to ministers to require you to stay at home, not to visit your ailing parents, to order you to wear a mask in certain circumstances, even, dare I say it, to stop you having a party, even if you all thought it'd be a very good idea. Now, that shows you how seriously secondary or delegated legislation can impact on your ordinary lives. Of course, there was an emergency. I'm not now arguing whether there should or should not have been these provisions. What I am making my point is, it was done, huge impact on all of you, all of us, by secondary legislation, so don't think delegated legislation or secondary legislation is trivial. There's supposed to be a controlling mechanism. Indeed, there are about 9 or 10, and it's very complicated to tell you them all, and it would waste your time and mine. There's supposed to be a number of ways in which the consent of both houses is required. Well, let's just think of the sort of legislation I have in mind. Let's take the Constitutional Reform and Governance Act Labour. Huge piece of legislation. Governance of the civil service, parliamentary standards, the ratification of treaties, freedom of information. What does it include? A minister of the Crown may make such provision by statutory instrument as he or she thinks appropriate in relation to any provisions of that major constitutional act, and to amend, repeal, or revoke any existing statutory provision, and include supplementary, incidental, transitional, transitory, or saving provision. There are no more words you can think of to add to that. And if there are, please tell me, and I'll tell the parliamentary draftsman, and he'll recognise that it's a gift from you. This is called a Henry VIII clause. It's so named because it was wrongly thought that such power had been vested in Henry VIII by the Act of Proclamations 1539. In fact, although Henry VIII asked for these powers, his parliament was not afraid to defy him. This monstrous tyrant, he wiped out the church, he'd done this, brought the monastery down, sacked his first wife because she'd slept with his brother when they were married, forgetting that he'd been sleeping with a girl who was the sister of another woman who'd carried a baby for him. I mean, it's wonderful, isn't it? I can give you a long catalogue about it, but it gave him a few powers he asked for, but it denied him the power to alter an act of Parliament or to interfere with existing rights. Well, we gave just such powers in the 2010 Act to a government minister. I would have been terrified of Henry VIII. I really would. But, I mean, you know, I'm sorry to say this, it sounds disparaging, but I'm not terrified in the same way by Gordon Brown or Tony Blair or David Cameron or Theresa May or Boris Johnson. I'm not terrified in the same way as I would have been. That Parliament said no, we say yes. Let's look at the Conservatives. This is the skeleton bill. The Child Care Act 2016 begins with a mission statement. Well, let me tell you what it says. We all agree that arrangements for the care of children is a really crucial piece of what society wants. Of course we do. But that's it. After that, it gives the minister 11 specific regulation-making powers, including regulations about revenue and customs, regulations if he wishes to create criminal offences punishable with imprisonment, regulations to impose financial penalties, and beyond all that, conferring a discretion on any person to make different provision for different purposes, to making consequential, incidental, supplemental, transitional, saving provision with power to amend, repeal, or revoke any provision made by or under an act whenever passed or made. In other words, this hugely important bill relating to the welfare of children and, of course, the consequential impact on parents and families and so on is handed over to the minister. By skeleton bills, they have power to make new laws before they even know what the laws should be, before they even have decided what their policy is. And that's a terrific handover, isn't it? You hand over power for laws to be made before the policy is known, and then you hand over power to get rid of laws which have been in force through Acts of Parliament, all by secondary legislation. That's not the end of it. There's legislative subdelegation of powers. There are now, you hand legislation over, so it's tertiary powers. And then there's what I call disguised legislation, guidance, determinations, or protocols, all of which make laws and often receive no parliamentary scrutiny at all. And thus, it doesn't take much to imagine, not only that executive power expands and control diminishes, but that we get used to the fact that executive power is expanding and that control of it is diminishing. Bear in mind, there is no power in either house to amend a statutory instrument. Isn't this extraordinary? 100 provisions in any statutory instrument, you look at it, believe you me, looking at 100 provisions in a statutory instrument takes a bit of concentration. But you think, 97 of these are terrific. How wise, how sensible. Let's have them. But you look and you say, well, three of them? Wow. No, they're stupid. They're damaging. They're not in anybody's interests. I disagree with those. If you throw out the three, you lose all the other 97, including some of the sensible ones. In any case, despite telling you that there are provisions, so many provisions about how this goes through the parliamentary system, they are never rejected. Would you allow me to give you some figures? Since 1950, I know, a long time ago, literally hundreds and hundreds, something approaching 200,000 statutory instruments prepared by government departments exercising powers granted to ministers have been laid before Parliament. Do the maths. In 70 years, 300,000, well, it's more than 2,000 a year. Yeah, 3,000 a year. And just for another, for instance, between 2005 until 2009, just so you have something of the scale, in every single year, between 11,000 and 13,000 pages of statutory instruments came into force. Now, a more devastating, shattering statistic than that. Ladies and gentlemen, since 1979, that is now over 40 years, the House of Commons has not rejected a single statutory instrument. Not one among all those thousands. Since 1950, the Lords has rejected six, the last in 2015. And this so shocked the Prime Minister of the day, he set up an immediate review, the object of which was to curtail the power of the Lords to interfere with statutory instruments. We do need to reflect rather carefully, don't we, on the powers exercised during most of our lifetimes, all your lifetimes, of all your students, of course, by the executive, effectively unchallenged. With delegated legislation, we don't have a trend to an overmighty executive. It is right there before our eyes. Can I add one little ironic twist about the 2015 Lord's decision? It served the government right, that is to say, the Labour government, which in 2006, under the Tax Credits Act, gave the minister power to alter benefits allowances. That's a sort of summary of a very complex situation. And the point the Labour Party had was that they could be increased without reverting to Parliament. Along comes a Conservative government, and Mr. Osborne was Chancellor of the Exchequer, and he used the same powers that had been given by a Labour House of Commons to a Labour government to remove something like over £4 million from the benefits system. And the important moral of the story is once these powers have been given to the executive, they remain in place. Whenever the electoral system provides us with a new and different executive. And on the whole, of course, whichever side wins, you know, you may not be too happy with whoever's won the election, but on the whole, we expect them all to behave sensibly, more or less sensibly, implementing their policies, which you may disagree with, but they are the policies. But you don't have to guarantee that we're going to have that. We do have to remember that some of the things that we find most distasteful of all, appalling, Nazi Germany, Hitler came to power through manipulating the electoral system. And what is worse, those Nazi laws, like apartheid South Africa, were all lawful. At the end of last year, two important reports were published. One, this is the title, Government by Diktat, a call to return power to Parliament. Two, democracy denied, that's a question mark, democracy denied, the urgent need to rebalance power between Parliament and the executive. The titles should be a warning to you and to all of us. These weren't the products of bright, sparky students. Maybe one of you wrote it, and that would be very good, because that's terrific. That's how students should be thinking, bright, intelligent. They weren't the product of eccentric academics. They came from two select committees of the House of Lords, the seconded Legislation Scrutiny Committee, the Regulatory Reform Committee, both entirely cross-party, both unanimous, and not one revolutionary among them. That's what they thought our constitution had come to. And let me explain this. The Delegated Powers Commission, the abuse of delegated powers is in effect an abuse of parliament and an abuse of democracy. And this report will, we hope, be a prompt to strengthen parliament in the coming years. And the other committee, this report is intended to issue a stark warning that the balance of power between parliament and government has for some time been shifting away from parliament. A critical moment has now been reached when that balance must be reset. 2 weeks ago, the Secondary Legislation Committee published its end of session report. What next? The growing imbalance between parliament and the executive, and records the government's response to the earlier reports. Almost all recommendations were rejected. Having read the responses myself, I regret that I entirely agree with that, and I was unsurprised. I'm not making a party political point, you must understand that. But you all know that very famous aphorism of Lord Acton about the tendency of power to corrupt. Putting it into the context of his very profound political philosophy, he wasn't referring to wads in brown envelopes. I mean, everybody knows that's corrupt. He wasn't referring to that. His deep concern was the way in which those vested with power tend to hanker after more of it. And we cannot assume that any party in government, whichever side is elected next time round, will happily surrender the increased levers of executive power, which have been accumulating steadily for the last 50 years. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm nearly at an end. I've got two things to say. The first is, in conversations with Roger, we used to discuss a resolution which passed in the House of Commons in 1780, 250 or so years ago. The influence of the Crown has increased, is increasing, and ought to be diminished. Take away the word the Crown, because the Crown is certainly has none of this power. Put in the executive, and those words would be true today. It worries me. It worried Roger Toulson. That such a resolution, successful in the Commons in 1780, would probably be defeated today. My last observation is to the, if you don't mind, but is to the students. This is your constitution. This is your country. You ought to live here for a very long time. And if people like you who have the advantage of the education you're receiving don't make sure that you understand what is going on in your own names, then it will only get worse. And then you wake up one day and you say, good Lord, that old buffer Lord Judge was right all along. Thank you very much. Right. I should say I can't see what time it is. I've been blinded. So all of you in the last five rows who want to leave can go now, and nobody will know you've gone.
Thank you, Lord Judge, for the wonderful remarks and for the very deep thought each and every one of us will have to give to the implications of those constitutional observations, some of which are deeply worrying indeed. Of course, with such a profound talk, we will expect equally profound questions from the audience. Can I start with Dr. Kenneth Ehrenberg?
Can we have more students than?
Yes, of course.
Yeah, sorry.
I can be really loud.
No.
All right, there are people online. I'm just a visitor here, so it's not my my role to criticize. I can see a lot of merit in what you've said. But two points, if I can just play devil's advocate for a moment. One is the comparison when we teach constitutional law and the idea of the elected dictatorship. I, at least in my tutorials, I always make the comparison to the gridlock in the United States and the worry that the alternative constitutional system that we see across the pond, as it were, results in an inability to tackle many of today's problems in a timely manner or indeed at all. So one problem is, you know, there's the risk of if we start taking away too much of that power from the executive, it won't be able to adjust to the kinds of daily tasks that need to be done. And to amplify that, this is the second point, is that perhaps the volatility and complexity of modern society requires more micromanagement than MPs can give.
Right, okay, thank you.
And that's why the voters are still, and this is the last point, the voters are the ultimate check on what the government does, not as much perhaps the MPs as we would like, precisely because we need someone to play that role of giving that micromanagement. Thanks.
Well, the first question, the United States Constitution is extraordinary. I mean, you know, you rebelled and you were determined not to have our system, and so you introduce yours, and it's completely daft. For example, yes, I'm not insulting you, I'm insulting the Constitution. But it is quite extraordinary that issues which are so societally important, such as termination of pregnancy, are decided by 9 human beings in a community of 170 million people. There we have the advantage of you. Judges do not have the power that your constitution gives to your judges. But your constitution works perfectly well, except you only have majorities about one or two each way round in your houses. Okay, but that's your democracy in action. That's how it works. If our democracy was in action and gave us a majority of two every time, we'd have to get much more used to the idea of minority governments and so on and so forth, and deals being done as they were in the Lib Dem conservative, what's the right word? No, I won't use the word that came to mind, but would you please erase that from your thinking? But of course, this, emergencies have to be dealt with. Of course they do. COVID was an emergency. It had to be dealt with. I was merely using that example to show that just in case people think delegated legislation is not very much here, it's about the pavements or the road signs or whatever, it is actually about affecting people's daily lives. That's why we have to be alert to the problem of delegated legislation. Governments have to deal with emergencies, and parliaments are very willing to allow them to have powers in emergencies. But that's not the same as allowing them to have powers on an almost daily basis. As for modern society, I really thought I'd made that point. We are very demanding of the people we put in power, increasingly so. And I think that their view is that there are going to be elections within 5 years, perhaps less. An awful lot of time is spent guarding the electoral potential. And that is why members of parliament spend less time in parliament and spend more time with their constituencies. I'm not being critical. That is the society we live in. I don't think there should be any micromanagement. I just think that when we pass laws, we should bear in mind what it is we are giving. And among the many, many hundreds, well, 200,000 or so, 200,000 I was talking about, of course, a lot of them are trivial. Nobody would be worried about them. I mean, a crank might be, but nobody would be. But when we get to the situation we get to where we give a minister power to create a criminal offence, to say it would be punishable by so much imprisonment, well, then we're straying to a very strange way, creating criminal offences by ministerial diktat. That we cannot have, we should not have. And I think that's probably dealt with the micromanagement point too. Thank you. I want somebody who's under 30 to put his or her hand up. Where's somebody who's reading jurisprudence who kindly met me when I came in? You're holding a microphone in your hand, young lady. Maybe you want to ask a question.
I am studying law and technology. That's jurisprudence guys over one of these ones, I think.
All right, if nobody under 30 wants to ask a question.
Credit for any of our jurisprudence PhDs.
Anybody who wants to ask a question. Over 30.
Gentlemen in the middle.
Neither of you under 30, okay, yes.
Very short question.
Yes. That's a very short question, and shall I start another lecture on the subject? A written constitution doesn't absolve governments of the problems that I'm referring to here. I've read the constitution of Russia. Would you believe it? I mean, what a nerdish thing to do. It's wonderful. It makes provision for this, for that, for the other, but I wouldn't want to live in Russia. Written constitutions can be subverted. Apartheid South Africa gave us, well, came from a constitution, from a written constitution. I think constitutions work better if the population which is subject to the constitution, whether written or unwritten, understands what limitations on executive power it wants to have. The other point which you make, it will never, ever be enacted. No party in power would consider for one moment saying, let's change all this, let's have a written constitution. So I don't espouse the cause. I think that constitutions can be written or unwritten. There are perfectly good constitutions that are written. And ours is a perfectly good constitution. What we have to beware of is that over the years, we have allowed things to slip. That's my message. We let more things go through on the basis the executive has to do it. I don't think a written constitution would solve the problems that I'm identifying, I'm afraid. I would like us to have a rule in Parliament that says, for example, a statutory instrument does not have to be defeated because one or two of its provisions are not accepted. But that's parliamentary process, it's no more than that. I'm sorry, sorry about the 3-hour lecture you haven't received. That's you. Try throwing your voice.
Have you any concerns
about the I have huge concerns about the composition of the House of Lords. It is far too large. The House of Lords itself has produced all sorts of plans to reduce its size, but see, this is an example of power. One of the things that any prime minister can say to any of his members, MPs, or get his chief whip to is, John, I gather you're not too pleased with this piece of legislation. It is your last parliament, isn't it? I gather you're retiring. Only the other day, the prime minister was saying to me, John might be just the sort of chap to go to the House of Lords. It is power. It's simply vested, it's absolutely vested in the Prime Minister of the day, and they will not give it up. Boris Johnson has created 84 peers in his time in power. Cameron with Clegg created about 200 plus. Blair created about 200 plus. If Labour wins the next election, they're only the third party in the House of Lords. There's Conservatives, of course. There's the crossbenchers, which I'm on. And Labour is next. They'll need another 100 to balance up against the Conservatives. They're about 100 behind them. And that's ridiculous. Your question is one that I would love to answer. Yes, and everybody thinks it's a very good idea. Everybody does, until it, like so many ideas, until it comes to decision-making time, and then it won't happen. But it is ridiculous. We need to have systems which limit the number of peers that there can be. We need about, if you add up the committees, and they do huge work, committees and the issues that arise, I personally think that the Lords should never be larger in number than the House of Commons. Okay, that's my very strong view. And if that means people over 90 have to retire, or over 80 have to retire, or put it the other way around, if somebody who's been there 25 years goes, because they've done 25 years, there are all sorts of ways in which it can be done, but nobody wants to take it up. Sorry.
Gentleman in the middle.
Yes.
I'll wait. understand your concern. Is there any way at all that you can conceive of that these could be prevented in our constitution? Sovereignty of Parliament means that every act of Parliament can override any previous act of Parliament. And once the genie is out of the bottle, it just depends on whether the government is sufficiently politically confident to decide that it can get such a decision.
The point is completely unanswerable. That's the point. It is the sovereignty of Parliament. And that is where we vest power. What it needs, though, is a little more circumspection. I'm now going back to, I think a lot of it started to go wrong. No, I better not. That's going to be a party political point. I won't make one. But then, lots of people have power. You don't have to exercise it. You don't have to test it to destruction. You do have to stand back and think, we are in power, but even though we beat the other lot, they're part of this system too. And the Constitution really needs us to be thinking about how to do things better. Of course, get our manifesto commitments. That's why we're in Parliament. We're in Parliament to achieve, shall we say, the nationalisation of the coal industry, the creation of the National Health Service. That's what we're doing. The other side don't go along with it. You've got parliamentary sovereignty and you exercise your power accordingly. But for much of the time, these aren't fundamentally different questions. They're different ways of looking at the same problem and different solutions to the same problem. But power needs to be exercised, as I said, circumspectly. But you're completely right. In our constitution, provided the bills go through the House of Commons, that's it, because the Lords can't hold it up except for the possibility of a tyranny by extending Parliament. Yeah, but go home happy. At least everybody here is thinking about it. I hope you all are thinking about it.
Thank you very much for this extraordinarily interesting presentation. I just want to identify a possible, and only a possible, tension between where you began and where you've ended, and it's come up a number of times in your responses just now, and that is you began with the suggestion that we ask too much of our government, and that was one of the driving causes of the problem that we face, and you ended with the aphorism suggesting that power just seeks its own accretion. Now, of course, both of these can be true, but in terms of how both of these identifications point to remedies, I'm wondering if you can say more in both regards, but perhaps in particular, should we, with regard to us asking too much of government, should we be asking less? Should we be asking other things? What is the intended remedy in that respect?
I'd love to offer a remedy. What I want is the government to implement its manifesto commitment to have an examination of our constitution, democracy, and rights as a whole, and get all the political parties to agree they will follow the recommendations of this wonderful commission which we don't yet have. You're completely right. I mean, this is the problem. We can't tell our society, look, stop asking the government for more, stop expecting the government to look after you, stop expecting the government to answer everything, because we are brought up, we are growing into that being the way we live. What matters is that the Constitution has itself to work in the flexible way it has, which has been its strength for centuries, by adapting to this new way without leaving the government of the day in possession of such wide, ultimately absolute powers. I've no answer to that. I'd love to. But society, I mean, the Constitution has to serve a moving society, an evolving society. And what to me is rather surprising and horrifying may not be surprising. I mean, I don't expect everybody here to have agreed with me. Young people may take a different view about it. And if they do, it's their future. But that's how it strikes me. I'd love to answer your question by saying, yes, leave it all to my ideas. We do need the issue to be examined very deeply. And we do need people to understand how embedded this situation is, particularly with statutory instruments, that the minister simply, well, the department listens to what the minister wants. They draft a statutory instrument. Sometimes they're very long, but they draft a statutory instrument, and that's put before the House. I'm told, and certainly reported in a very reputable publication, that members of the House of Commons who are put in to a committee to examine some statutory legislation that needs some affirmative consent are put in by whips as a punishment for not following the party line assiduously enough. And that the average length of one of those committee meetings is 30 minutes. No wonder they are passed. There was a lady over there who may have been missed. Oh, maybe I missed her. Sorry, yes, that lady there, sorry. Sorry, she's probably in your shade.
Hi, thanks so much. It's been very interesting. I have to say you've painted quite a gloomy picture,
yes.
But one that I think I agree with. And in some of my work, I've seen with things like the rollout of universal credit through statutory instruments and the sort of lack of scrutiny that happens there. And you slightly touched on what my question was going to be. But I suppose my question is, do you think there's hope that there will be a rebalance? And if you do, what things do you think would need to happen to do that rebalance?
I think there will be a rebalance. That is an expression which has an awful lot of hope in it, rather than clear, rigid thinking. More heart, if you like, than head. But we do have an extraordinary constitution. We live in the most wonderful country in which our constitution is flexible. And it needs the population to realize what is going on and then start asking questions of their members of parliament. Now, when did you last object to a statutory instrument? The statutory instrument provides this. Of course, if you've been a Labour supporter when the Tax Credits Act was passed, you'd have said, terrific, that's what we want. We want the government to be able to produce more money. But if you've been a Conservative, you've been saying to your MP, why didn't you oppose that? It's going to dish out money. And then the other way around, when it comes in, it's billion pounds that's going to be dished out by way of credits. What on earth were you doing? Not objecting that if you're Labour. And they didn't. It got to us and the Lords to object. And then, as I say, we caused a constitutional crisis that had the Prime Minister running around saying we're not following the will of the elected House. So my short answer is, I'm sorry it's gloomy, I think we live in a wonderful country. I think it's remarkable how tolerant we are of the sort of idiot views that people express, including my own. You're allowed to express them. People listen. People have the courtesy to listen. But constitutions take time to catch up. We don't want to cut off the Prime Minister's head, you know, just like we did with Charles I. That's a bit excessive. But as I said, I go back to confirm the serious point. I'm more in hope than expectation, but I do hope that when people realise the sort of way in which laws, for example, the COVID laws were passed, I mean, some people thought they were dreadful, dreadful laws. Did they appreciate it was done just by a minister signing a document? I doubt if they did. They thought, if I may go back to the question I was asked at the beginning, well, this is the government dealing with an emergency, and fine, got to put up with things we don't like because it's an emergency. I mean, this is all perfectly reasonable. But did they realise that it was just a minister signing a document that said, no, you can't go and visit Granny, or whatever it might be? That's the point.
I think one more question.
Yes.
Two more,
and then okay. And then I can... Look, they're all disappearing at the back. Look at them all. They're wanting to go. Yes.
Thank you. And now for something completely different, if I may.
Yes.
I was extremely interested in your speech, but what interested me most wasn't only what you said, but how you said it, particularly from the point of view of the methodology which you used. You gave what I would define an example of the power of historical knowledge. You provided a very strong historical foundation to your statements, and you explained that you discussed about history with Lord Toulson as well, and I imagine with other judges at your same level. What are your views? And I'm talking as an ancient historian, or legal historian, I should say, not only, but this is one of my expertise. What do you think? Someone in your position looks to the new generations and it says that history seems to disappear from curricula. What matters is only what happens in this very second. A little bit as you described for politics seems to happen also in other sectors. So I would like to know your views as regards not only the power of history, which you probably share, because otherwise you wouldn't have used this particular methodology, but the developments that we see nowadays.
Well, of course, if you're studying any subject, there are lots of things to study. But I would like people who do a law degree to have a paper on constitutional law, constitutional history, rather. Constitutional law, constitutional history, the same subject. How did we get where we are today, and where did it all start? Way back to Magna Carta. Did you go back to the laws of Edward the Confessor, if you like? But that might be a bit unnecessary. I had the great advantage of going to university, wanting to be a barrister, and getting there, and being advised by my director of studies, who first of all cross-examined me about whether I wanted to be a lawyer really, had I thought about it, had I really realized what going to the bar would be like, and so on and so on and so on. And he said to me at the end of 20 minutes cross-examination, well, you have thought about it. Now I've got some advice for you. This is 1959. His advice was, read history. You can read any history you like, history of political thought, constitutional history, and I did. And my very last conversation with him, when he was a very fragile old man, was to thank him for that advice. I do think lawyers need to have, it doesn't have to be history, actually, it could be chemistry. They need to have a foundation in something else if they're going to be in the law. It's to do with perspective, but it's true for all of us. So the answer to your question is yes, but you know, I'm not a university person in charge of the way these courses are set up. And I might be saying to something like, yes, I really thoroughly agree with you, and find that they'll have to drop the law of contract or whatever it might be. Because, I mean, you do work very hard, don't you, up at the back? I love history. I always have done. And a number of my colleagues have, if you like, a historical background. They understand it. But you do also have to remember that it was 1959 that I went up to university, and in about the middle of the 1990s, suddenly we didn't have any more history. You know, the world began. And that is such a great shame.
I think one last question at the gentleman at the back.
Yeah. Well, your point about emergency is a perfectly fair one, but nothing in the climate change menu, and there's a lot of it, requires that there should not be proper legislation and time to debate the issues and decisions to be made. I'm not one of those who likes to live in a world which works at hectic pace. And I'll tell you a story that goes back to my time when I held office. I had the most wonderful secretary. And my second morning, she came in and she said, there are 42 emails overnight, my lord. They're, you know, will you deal with them now? Well, I happened to be sitting in court, so I couldn't. But I said to her, Eleanor, look through all of them and only bring me the ones that will still be urgent in the morning. tomorrow morning, because actually we flash around with our technology, where's the young lady with the technology degree, and we turn ourselves into robots. I mean, how many of you just leave your iPad, so put it to bed now, say 7 o'clock, and don't look at it again till tomorrow morning? Not many hands are going up. Yes, not among the younger ones among you. And I know why you do it, because you live your lives on it. But don't confuse. There's a great tendency to confuse activity with action. Activity, we can all rush around being active. Action means settling down and thinking through what it is that should happen and how it should happen, and how it should happen then requires a lot of further answers. So my answer to your question is, you're right, there are emergencies. I'm not decrying the point that there's a climate emergency. I'm not decrying it. But really, we don't need to solve it tomorrow. We need to think through what it is we want to do. We need to examine the evidence, how to do it best, and then how we're going to raise the money to deal with that when we also have the health service to pay for, the education, the defence. That's all political decisions. We can't rush at them. So anyway, put your email away for tonight. Don't look at your iPad till tomorrow morning, and have a very good evening.